A doctor in California called me here months ago, and he asked me, Rick, he said, would you mind telling me, he said, what you were thinking when you put that up on the internet? And I just simply said, look, when every second person knows how to cure their own cancer, how's the system going to stand against it? And he laughed. He said, what you've done, he said, you've let the genie out of the bottle, and they can't put it back in.
Good for you.
And the people, I mean, there are people that are waking up to the reality of this, and there's a young gentleman right here. Would you mind speaking a little bit, Chris?
I guess. I was just in the middle of university, just finishing up before I first
Would you like to come up here?
Yes.
I'm very proud of this young man for the action that he took. Go ahead, Chris.
Well, my action wasn't so bold at first as much was cop-out from finishing up university. I was just in the middle of my fourth year, and I started to stumble across Rick's information. And it really sort of put my mind into a spinning loophole in my life, into a circle, because I had really convinced myself that everything I was learning in university was, you know, for a path that I was following to relieve a great deal of suffering, hopefully at the end of the tunnel. But what I came to realize was that the information that Rick was sharing, which I discovered just simply through stumbling across it on the internet, wasn't just some sort of, fly-by-night cure that was making a few dollars for someone and being touted as, some miracle drug. But when I went back and started looking at the studies from the same journals and the same sources that the information that I was being taught was coming from, I discovered that cannabis and cannabinoid therapies were already being presented across the world in these same publications. But when I wanted to talk to my professors about it, or I sat back and looked at what I'd learned in the past 4 years, I realized that this had been completely kept from me and that there was really no interest in discussing this or moving forward on any of this new research. And so it really caused me to step back from the university community altogether and start to look at new ways of relieving suffering in the world. And I think that's what I'm hopefully doing right now.
The world needs more people like Chris. People that stand up for what's right instead of swallowing the garbage they give us. Any more questions?
Rick, how can the everyday people, across the world help you? Like, that want to come out and try to do something to help further your work? What would be a way that they could contribute?
Well, you start by strangling your politicians. I mean, unfortunately, the system here, I mean, the big money is running everything. The government controls the government. There's no question about that. And the government controls the policing and the medical system, the legal system, all of it. So it starts right from the top to the bottom. But I mean, these police officers and all these people that are out there doing these raids and whatnot, well, do their families not get cancer? So what are these people thinking? The change is coming. It's funny here. About 2 weeks ago, a lady came over from Prince Edward Island, and she came in there with her father, and she sat down, and she had terminal cancer. So she said to me, she said, you'll never guess, she said, who sent me? And I said, would it be your doctor? And she said, oh, I do know a doctor on the island that sends people to you. And I said, yeah, that's right. She said, no, it wasn't my doctor. She said, two of my friends are narcotics officers. They told me I should come see you. So it's like I said, they get cancer too. But I mean, they have to wise up and realize what they're doing to the public. Any more questions?
Are there specific strains that you would look for when you're going to purchase some product on the street, specifically for cancer treatment?
Well,
or do you just stick basically to a strong indica that gives you a certain sedative?
Well, I always look for that strong indica, around 20% or more THC. But, I've used White Widow a great deal, which is a very good strain. It's about 19% THC. The problem is with this thing here, is when you send for seeds or anything, you're still at the mercy of the seed merchants, because you don't know what you're getting. But the more powerful strains, as far as I'm concerned, the more power, the better. You know, I have these commercials where they say, the marijuana available on the street today is 10 times stronger than the stuff you smoke. Well, I hate to tell the government this, but I wish it was 1,000 times stronger. Then that way you could take a whole lot less medicine, couldn't you? It's all nonsense. The whole thing is just a smokescreen, what they've done.
So the doctors just make up I know a lady that grew it. She used to get it from the doctors. And I've been smoking since I was 25. And I smoked this stuff from the doctor. This shit. You know, like, and then, like, if there's a good joint, you give me a joint, I can tell you by the second gray if it's good or not. That's, you know, that's the way I've done it. And, like, it's, like, Rick is the one that we went to see him. I only had 2 months to live. And when I walked out of there, I had that much hope. Because I was coming down here and taking a swan dive off the bridge. That's what I had planned. But
he changed my life. Yeah.
Now, any other questions? Oh, must be somebody out there. Oh, go ahead, Jordan.
I was going to ask about Jack Hare's use of the medicine and him talking about it to the public. Because
yes, that should be mentioned.
I know a lot of crazy stories he's been telling me for the past week.
Well, Jack contacted me about a year ago, shortly after the documentary Run from the Cure came out. We got an email first from Chuck Jacobs. He said he was Jack's assistant. And when we got the email, I went, well, maybe it is Jack Hare, maybe it isn't. But then about a week later, I get this phone call, and it's Jack. And, I mean, I couldn't believe it. But it was a strange thing meeting Jack, or talking to him. But we talked quite a bit. The first question he asked me was about leukemia. And I didn't understand at the time that his friend Captain Ed had died in 1991 from leukemia. And it was unfortunately, it was my unpleasant task to tell Jack that leukemia is one of the easiest cancers to cure. But then Jack asked me to go on his internet TV show. Well, then I explained to him, I said, I can't come to the States, I said, because I've been labeled a criminal by our system here in Canada. And very shortly, we're going to find out who the real criminals are. Because I don't think it's me for helping people. But I went on Jack's show, and when I talked to Jack, he was having a hard time talking. And I didn't understand, you know, what was going on. So then when I got talking to him on the show, like, he told me, he said, I had a stroke in 2001. It left me with about 15% use of one side of my body. His face was sagged. His speech was all slurred. And Jack's a diabetic ulcers. And so instantly I started, I said, oh my God, I said, you're Jack Hare. You know, get on this stuff as quick as possible. So apparently in the beginning, they didn't have real high grade to work with. You'd think if anybody in this world had good butt, it would be Jack Hare. But that's not the way it was. So they began making the oil with shake, just leaves and things. So I was on Jack's show. I've been on Jack's show, God, over a dozen times, I think. But about 45 days after Jack started taking the oil, I was on an episode there, and Eddie Lepp, he's another very well-known hemp activist in California. Eddie was on the show with Jack. And Eddie said, Ricky said, I was there the first day Jack Hare took a dose of that oil. And he said, 1 week later, I started. He said, you could see the difference every day. And he said, just the other day here, he said, Jack and I were over to a big gathering to do with hemp in Oakland. And he said, Jack, I watched Jack. He said he was all over the fairgrounds talking to all the vendors. And he said, Rick, he said, 45 days ago, when Jack Hare started taking that oil, he couldn't walk 15 feet. And he said, now he's strutting around like a rooster. He said, unbelievable difference. But over the months, I've become quite close with Jack, and I have such admiration for the man. You know, I mean, a lot of people called me a nut in the beginning. Oh, that guy's a drug dealer, he's crazy, and this doesn't work. Well, Jack's been going through that for 40 years. I mean, back in the 70s, they all tried to say that he was insane, but Jack proved them all wrong, didn't he? And that's what makes him the greatest hemp activist that ever lived, because he's withstood the punishment, and he's still there. And Jack wants to see this probably legalized even more than I do. So I'm proud to call him a friend. Mm-hmm.